Praise the Lord. Let's have a word of prayer. Father, we thank you for this day of worship. Thank you for your word. Thank you for the commission. Thank you for your commandment. Thank you, Lord, because you're speaking to the church today. And we pray every one of us will hear you speaking to us personally in Jesus' name. Accomplish your will in us, that we may go forth into the world and accomplish your will in the world. Thank you, Lord, for the answer. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you. You can sit down. Again, we're coming back to Revelation chapter 18. And we're reading from verse 1 through to verse 5. Revelation chapter 18, verse 1. And after these things, I saw another angel come down from heaven, having great power, and the earth was lightened by his glory. In verse 2, he tells us, and he cried mightily with a strong voice, saying, Babylon the great is falling, and it's become the habitation of devils and the hold of every foul, dirty, filthy spirit, and the cage of every unclean and hateful bird. Then in verse 3, it tells us, for all nations have drunk of the wine of the wrath of her fornication, and the kings of the earth have committed fornication with her, and the merchants of the earth are waxed rich through the abundance of her delicacies. Verse 4 then says, and I heard another voice from heaven saying, come out. Come out of her, my people, that she be not partakers of her sins, and that she receive not of her plagues. Then in verse 5, for her sins have reached up unto heaven, and God has remembered her iniquities. As we look at verse 4, it gives us a commandment from heaven. And it says, and I heard another voice from heaven. And that voice says, come out of her. Come out of Babylon. Falling Babylon. Forsaking Babylon. Filthy Babylon. Come out of her, my people. The people who are saved, those who are redeemed, those who are forgiven, those who are purchased by the blood of the Lamb, that ye be not partakers of her sins, that ye receive not of her plagues. As we look at the word this morning, we're considering the subject, an urgent call out from falling Babylon. An urgent call out from falling Babylon. Three things we're looking at. Number one, the heavenly commandment. Number two, the holy commandment. Number three, the high calling. Number one, come out of Babylon. Number two, cut off from the beast. Number three, come up to build a land. Look at number one. In number one, the heavenly commandment, come out of Babylon. We come back again to Revelation chapter 18, verse 4. And I heard another voice from heaven. John heard the voice, standing in there for the church. And the church should hear the voice, especially at this time, at the closing of the age, the church should hear the voice from heaven. Every Christian, every believer, every member of the church, every minister should hear the voice from heaven saying, come out of her, my people, that ye be not partakers of her sins, and that ye receive not of her plagues. Three things we look at. Number one, come out of the filthiness of present day Babylon. Number two, cast off the fruits of perverted Babylon. Number three, here, call others from the falling away of polluted Babylon. Look at number one, come out of the filthiness of present day Babylon. In Jeremiah chapter 51, reading from verse 6, flee out of the midst of Babylon. Don't just walk out, sneak out. Make up your mind. Babylon is falling, and Babylon represents the present world system. And the Lord says, by the angel crying from heaven, and the Lord says, my spirit today, and the Lord says, in the word that cries and pierces the heart of every man and every woman, flee, flee out of the midst of Babylon, and deliver every man his soul, and deliver every man his soul. Christ died for everyone. But you have to make up your mind that as Babylon is falling and falling, that you will come out, not only think about it, not only meditate about it, not only plan about it, that you take the step, you come out, you run out, you flee out of the midst of Babylon and deliver every man his soul, and be not caught up in her iniquity. Don't copy her. Don't follow her. Don't imbibe their principles. Don't follow their practices. And be not caught, that you be not caught up in their iniquity. For this is the time of the Lord's vengeance. He will render unto her a recompense. Look at verse 45 there. In verse 45, my people, go ye out. Come out, flee out, go ye out of the midst of her, and deliver ye every man his soul from the fierce anger of the Lord. Have you noticed something there? He says, there is people, they are purchased by the blood of the Lamb, they are saved by the grace of God, and yet he says, even after you are saved, even after you have become a child of God, to them that believe him, to them he gave power, he gave authority, he gave the right to become the sons of God. Even those who believed on his name, even after we have believed, the call is still coming from heaven, come out, flee out, and go out of Babylon. We must keep ourselves separated from Babylon. It tells us in 2 Corinthians chapter 6, and I'm reading from verse 17. Here are the words of the Lord Almighty himself, as he says, wherefore come out from among them, and be ye separate, says the Lord, and touch not, of course, taste not, of course, don't go along with them. Don't wear what they wear, drink what they drink, attend their parties. Be not part of them. Distinguish yourself as a peculiar person, a purchased person, a purified person, totally distinct and different from Babylon. Touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you. And then in verse 18 it says, and I will be a father unto you, and ye shall be my sons and my daughters, says the Lord Almighty. And he that has an ear will hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. Come out, you come out in Jesus' name. Look at number two here. Number two is to cast off the fruits of perverted Babylon. Babylon is that world, wild influence. Babylon is that influence that comes from the source of the God of this world and spreads throughout the world, and the world is perverted because of that. And it says we cast off the fruit of perverted Babylon. It tells us in Hosea chapter 8, reading from verse 3, Hosea chapter 8, reading from verse 3, it says Israel has cast off the thing that is good, and the enemy shall pursue him. The children of Israel cast off the law of God, the law of love. Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. They cast off the law of God Almighty. He gave them the Ten Commandments, and they were to obey that. They cast off the law of the priesthood. They were to follow a particular pattern as a chosen race, as a peculiar people, as the priests of God. They cast off the law from their conscience. Their conscience again will not bear witness to the word of God. They cast off the restraint of the law that restrained them, that they should not follow after the Gentiles, after the heathen. And the word of God says Israel has cast off that which is good, and the enemy shall pursue them. What was their thinking after they cast off the thing that is good? It tells us in verse 12. It says in verse 12, I have written to him the great things of my law, but they were counted as a strange thing. They did the exact opposite to the thing the Lord had called them to do. They should have cast off the fruits of perverted Babylon, but no, they didn't do that. They cast off the thing that is good. In Ezekiel chapter 18, verse 31, Ezekiel 18, 31, cast away from you all your transgressions. The Lord does not deal in half measures. The Lord does not accept, I cast a bit off, a part off, half of my iniquities, and the ones that is paining me, and the one that is poisoning my life, but the other ones I enjoy, the other ones I delight in. And so how can I cast that one off? Look at the word of God there in verse 31, cast away from you all your transgressions, everything. Bundle them together. If you're going to be acceptable to God, it's not just by word of mouth, I cast off Babylon, but all the transgressions, all the iniquities you cast, everything of whereby ye have transgressed, and make you a new heart and a new spirit. For why will ye die, O house of Israel? Let me remind you that God said, Israel is my son. Let my son go that they may serve me. And now the Lord is telling that same Israel, if they partook in the sins of perverted Babylon, if they took part in the sins of polluted Babylon, if they partook in the sins of those people in Babylon that went away from the Lord and they served their idols and they practiced their practices, even though God referred to them as my son, if they died in those sins of Babylon, they'll die forever, separated from the Lord. That's why he's saying, cast them off. Don't cast off the law of God. Don't cast off the law of love. Don't cast off the law for the priesthood. Don't cast off the law that is registered and written in your conscience. But cast off all your transgressions whereby ye have transgressed against me, and make you a new heart and a new spirit. For why will ye die, O house of Israel? In verse 32 it says, for I have no pleasure in the death of him that died. Yet the sinner who continues in sin will die in sin. I have no pleasure in those who die, yet because this is the vengeance of God, and this is the principle of his operation. The people that remain in sin, though God does not have pleasure in their death, they will die. The soul that sinneth, they will die. That's why he's saying, turn away from sin, cast off the sin, and cast off the iniquity, for I have no pleasure in the death of him that died, says the Lord God. Wherefore, because of that, because of your soul, because of your eternity, and because you need to escape the judgment that is coming upon the world, turn yourselves and live ye. Look at number three here. Number three is talking about what we do now to others, call others from falling away or polluted, the falling away or polluted Babylon. As you are coming out, remember your children, bring them out with you. As you are coming out, remember your parents, bring them along with you. As you are coming out, when it says come out of Babylon, because Babylon is falling, you will remember your loved ones, you remember your neighbors, love others, love your neighbor as you love yourself. You don't want to partake in the judgment. You do not want to perish in the judgment. Therefore, call others from the falling away of polluted Babylon. Actually, the world in which we're living now, the age in which we're living, if you look at 2 Timothy chapter 4, reading from verse 3, chapter 4 of 2 Timothy verse 3, it says, for the time will come. That was at that time, 2,000 years ago, the time will come. Now, 2,000 years after, the time has come. When they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own laws shall they heap to themselves teachers, having itching ears. And look at verse 4, it says, they shall turn away their ears from the truth of the gospel, the truth that saves, the truth that sanctifies, the truth that cleanses the heart, and the truth that keeps us away from sinning. They will turn their ears away from that, and then they shall be turned unto fables. What are we to do then as evangelists? What are we to do as witnesses to the Lord Jesus Christ? What are we to do as soul winners then? Look at verse 5. It says, but watch thou in all things. Watch over all the doctrine, watch over all the caution, and watch over all the things that the Lord is saying, and the consecrations we have made in the past, the commitment we have made in the past. Watch thou in all things, endure afflictions. Endure afflictions. There's no affliction that comes now in the Christian race to be compared with the afflictions in the early church. Stephen was stoned to death. That's not happening in many places today. And then we know that Paul the apostle and Peter and those apostles, some of them were beheaded and some of them were nailed to the cross. That's not happening now. The light affliction we have now, the light difficulties we have now, and the light trials we have now, endure afflictions. Do the work of an evangelist, even when they are not hearing, when they don't want to hear, and when they are turning unto fables. Let us call all others out from the falling away of polluted Babylon. And then it says, make full proof of thy ministry. I pray the Lord will help us to bring others out of polluted Babylon in Jesus' name. Look at Micah chapter 2. I'm reading from verse 10. In Micah chapter 2, we're looking at verse 10. It says, arise ye and depart, for this is not your rest. There was no rest in Egypt for the children of Israel. There was no rest in Sodom and Gomorrah for Lot. There was no rest in the antediluvian world for Noah. And there's no rest. There was no rest in Abraham in the awe of Chaldees. Because there was no rest for them there, that's why the Lord said, come on, and for us of this present age, for us at this time in spiritual Babylon, it says we don't have any rest there. Arise ye, depart, for this is not your rest, for it is polluted, and it shall destroy you, even with a sword destruction. And as you come out, you come into the hands of the Lord. You come into the bosom of the Savior. You come out of darkness, you come into the light. You come out of pollution, and you come to the perfect embrace of the Lord Jesus Christ. and is willing to forget the past, is willing to forgive the past, is willing to make you break from the past, and is able to give you the grace as you come into the hands of the Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, the heavenly commandment is, come out of Babylon. We come to point number two, and point number two is the holy commandment cut off from the beast. As you come to the book of Revelation, one, you have the beast, two, you also have Babylon. Let's look at Revelation chapter 17, and I'm reading there from verse 86, the beast that thou sawest was and is not, and shall ascend out of the bottomless pit and go into perdition, and they that dwell on the earth shall wonder, whose names were not written in the book of life from the foundation of the world, when they behold the beast that was and is not and yet is. There is the beast is actually the symbol of the false prophet and the antichrist will come. And the word of God says that the spirit of the antichrist is now at work. And the holy commandment of the Lord is to cut off from the beast. There are three things we're looking at. Number one is the character and the condemnation of the beast. Number two is the conversion and the cleansing from beastliness. From beastliness. And then number three is the consecration and circumcision of believers. Look at number one there, the character and the condemnation of the beast. It tells us in Revelation chapter 13, reading from verse 1, and I stood upon the sand of the sea and saw a beast rise up out of the sea of humanity, having seven heads and ten horns, and upon his horns ten crowns, and upon his heads, listen to this, the name of blasphemy. His character will be a blasphemous character. It will be a disgraceful character. It will be a character that is opposed to Christ, opposed to godliness, and opposed to the people of God. It tells us in verse 5 of that chapter 13, and it says, and there was given unto him a mouth speaking great things and blasphemies, and power was given unto him to continue 40 and 2 months. 40 and 2 months, that's 3.5 years. It tells us in verse 8. In verse 8, it tells us, and all that dwell upon the earth shall worship him. Bad character, they shall worship him. Blasphemous character, they'll worship him, whose names are not written in the book of life and of the Lamb, slain from the foundation of the world. It tells us in chapter 16, Revelation chapter 16, verse 10, and then here we're still told about the character and about the condemnation of the beast. It says, and the fifth angel poured out his vial upon the seat of the beast, and his kingdom was full of darkness, and they gnawed their tongues for pain. They'll have the plague, they'll have the plague, and they will have the punishment coming from the Almighty God. It tells us in chapter 19, reading from verse 19. Chapter 19, reading from verse 19, still talking to us about the character and about the condemnation of the beast. He said, and I saw the beast and the kings of the earth and their armies gathered together to make war against him that sat on the horse and against his army. They'll be fighting against the Lord, against our Christ, against the King of Kings, against the Lord of Lords. But then it says in verse 20, and the beast was taken, and with him the false prophet that wrought miracles before him, which he deceived the world, them that had received the mark of the beast, and them that worshipped his image. And these both, the beast and the false prophet, were cast alive into a lake of fire, burning with brimstone. They'll be there forever and ever. You'll not be a partaker of the judgment that will come upon them in Jesus' name. Look at number two here. Number two is the conversion and the cleansing from beastliness. Now what that means is the nature of man is the nature of the beast. The lion gets angry and the lion destroys the nature of the natural man. And then all the nature of the beast and the beastliness in man, we can be converted from them. We can be turned around from them. We can be transformed from them. Hey, look at 2 Peter chapter 2, reading from verse 12, talking about the beastly nature of the natural man that does not know God, the natural man that is not born again, the natural man whose heart had not been transformed, had not been changed, had not been converted by the Lord, has the nature of a beast. And it says in 2 Peter chapter 2 verse 12, but these as natural brute beasts, he's talking about man, talking about people, talking about the unsaved, talking about the sinner, and he says they're as natural brute beasts made to be taken and destroyed. They speak evil of the things that they understand not and shall utterly perish in their corruption. That's what the Lord wants to save everyone from. And then in verse 13, he tells us, and he shall receive the reward of the unrighteous, of unrighteousness, as they that count each pleasure to riot in daytime, sports they are, and blemishes, sporting themselves with their own deceivings while they feast with you. Some of those people, beastly nature, they even come to church and they gather with the people of God and they partake in all the outward forms of religion, but their hearts are not transformed. And it says they feast with you. Some of them even sneak in and they take the Lord's Supper, and yet they're not born again. The Lord wants us to understand water baptism is not conversion, Holy Communion is not conversion, and washing of feet for those who do that is not conversion, and all the rites and the ceremonies of worship, they're not conversion. If we do not have the beastly nature, if we do not have the animal nature, if we do not have the depravity taken out of our hearts, of our lives, we'll spend eternity with people that never went to any church. But the Lord wants conversion. He wants a change. That's why Jesus came. Jesus did not just bring religion, he brought righteousness. And he brought conversion. He brought a change, the change from heaven. And when that Christ comes into our heart, he's able to turn the heart around and turn the life around and make us new creatures in Christ. And if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things, old life, old character, old comportment, old beastliness is taken away, and all things become new. We're told in Acts chapter 3 verse 19. Acts chapter 3 verse 19. Repent ye therefore to be converted. Repent ye therefore to be a child of God. Repent ye therefore to have the operation of the grace of God working in our hearts, turning us in the right direction and making us to walk in the narrow path and the narrow way that leads to heaven. Repent ye therefore and be converted. And be converted. If you're converted, people around you will know. If you're converted, the people in the office will know. If you're converted, the people who have seen you in your unconverted beastly, evil, sinful days, they will know a change has now happened. And that's exactly why Christ came and he said, be converted, that your sins may be blotted out when the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord. If you are not there yet, you'll get there today in Jesus' name. Look at verse 26. In verse 26, it tells us that Jesus Christ unto you, first God, having raised up his son, Jesus sent him to bless you. What's the blessing? In turning away every one of you from his iniquity. That's the duty of the Lord. And that is the responsibility of the Lord. That's the operation of the Lord. If Jesus ever came to any life, that's what he will do. He will turn every one of you from his iniquities. Let's look at number three there. Number three there is the consecration and the circumcision of believers. The consecration and the circumcision of believers. In Romans chapter 12, reading from verse 1, I beseech you therefore, brethren, these ones are saved. Brethren, these ones are born again. Brethren, these ones are already members of the body of Christ. Brethren, I beseech you therefore, because of all he has done, therefore, because of his suffering for you, therefore, because of the shedding of his blood, therefore, because he bestowed his love upon you in forgiving you all your sins, therefore, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies, that's a consecration, that's a commitment, that he presented himself for us as a sin offering, as a substitute, and now we present ourselves unto him, a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And then he tells us in verse 2, he says, and be not conformed to this world, Babylon, and be not conformed to this world, spiritual Egypt, and be not conformed to this world, Sodom and Gomorrah, and be not conformed to this corrupt world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and the perfect will of God. Look at Deuteronomy chapter 30, and we're reading from verse 6. Deuteronomy chapter 30, verse 6, and the Lord thy God. In the New Testament language, this was a saved. The Lord thy God is not the God of the sinner. Jesus told those sinners, ye of your father the devil, and the works of your father you will do. He was a liar from the beginning, and when he speaketh a lie, he speaks of his own. But the people who have come away out of the hands, out of the hood, out of the family of the father of the world, that is of the God of this world, they become the children of God, and we refer to God as God the Lord thy God. They were saved and purchased and redeemed, and the Lord thy God will circumcise thine heart. That's what the New Testament calls sanctification. You are saved when your sins are forgiven. You are saved when I see the blood, I will pass over you. You are saved, you come out of Egypt. But now, after coming out of Egypt, that same God that saved you will circumcise your heart, will purify your heart, will cleanse your heart, will sanctify you. And when he does that, he will do that for your seed as well, which means sanctification is not just for the people of old, from generation to generation to generation. That holiness experience, that sanctification is for their seed. And we are the seed of Abraham. And now he says he sanctifies us. And when he does that, to love the Lord thy God with all thine heart and with all thy soul, that thou mayest live. You will live. I will live. The Lord confirmed that in our lives in Jesus' name. Let's come to point number three. Now, point number three, the high calling, come up to Beulah. Come up. You come out and you come through And then you come up to Beulah. It's not enough to come out of Egypt. How many of those Israelites that came out of Egypt, how many of them got to Beulah land? How many of them got to the promised land? How many of them got to the land of Canaan? He brings us out, that he may bring us through, and then he'll bring us up to Beulah. He tells us in Isaiah chapter 62, and I'm reading from verse 4. In Isaiah chapter 62, verse 4, it says, thou shalt be no more termed forsaken, neither shall thy land anymore be termed desolate, but thou shalt be called Hephzibah, and thy land Beulah. That is the land where they settled, the land of Canaan, a picture of heaven, a picture of the place that Jesus said, in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you, I go to prepare a place for you. And when I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, so that where I am, not Egypt, so that where I am, not Babylon, so that where I am, not Sodom, so that where I am, not the earthly Jerusalem, so that where I am, heavenly glory, there ye shall be also. And it says, it is Beulah, for the Lord delighted in thee, and thy land shall be married. Somebody shout, amen. Number one here is the contemplation of Beulah. The contemplation. You are thinking about that final day and that final place and that glorious place, Beulah. The contemplation of Beulah. Number two is the condition of the bride. Number three is the call to all believers. Look at number one. Number one, the contemplation of Beulah. Is heaven in your thoughts? Is glory in your thoughts? Are the mansions that Jesus promised a day in your thoughts? Are you only buried in the things of the world? Are you mixing yourself with the sand and the cement and the gravels of this world? Is it only what you see that attracts your attention? Or do you have the contemplation and the consideration and the thinking of and the affection of the land above? In Colossians chapter 3, I'm reading from verse 1. Colossians chapter 3, reading from verse 1. If ye then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. And then in verse 2, he tells us, set your affection on things above. Think of things above. Look at things above, meditate on things above, contemplate on things above, and let your mind be filled with the expectation and the hope of the things above. Set your affection on things above, not on things on the earth. In verse 3, it says, for ye are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God. And then it says in verse 4, when Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then he shall appear with him in glory. Then I will appear with him in glory. Be it fulfilled in our lives in Jesus' name. Let's look at number two. Number two is talking about the condition of the bride. The condition of the bride. If we're going to be there, and thank God we're going to be there, we must have our mind on the condition that the Lord has said for the bride. In 2 Corinthians chapter 11, I'm reading from verse 2. 2 Corinthians chapter 11, we're reading from verse 2. It says, for I am jealous over you with godly jealousy, for I have espoused you to one husband, that I may present you as a chaste virgin to Christ. That's the condition of the bride. The condition of the bride when Christ will come, and the people, the saints of God, the sanctified ones and the holy ones, the people that have been washed and cleansed and purged and purified by the blood of the Lamb, the condition he wants us to be when he comes, and then he will take us away. And when the saints go marching in, who will be among them? I said, who will be among them? You'll be there. Nobody will take your place. And your seat will not be given to another one in Jesus' name. Look at Revelation chapter 14. Revelation chapter 14, I'm reading from verse 4. It says, these are they which are not defiled with women, for they are virgins. These are they which follow the Lamb whithersoever he goeth. These who are redeemed from among men, being the first fruits unto God and to the Lamb. And then it says in verse 5, and in their mouth was found no guile, for they are without fault before the throne of God. I pray you'll be among the number. Saved, you'll be among the number. Sanctified, you'll be among the number. Spiritually a virgin, you'll be among the number. Perfected and spotless and blameless by the washing of the blood of the Lamb, you'll be among the number in Jesus' name. Now number three here is talking about the call to all believers who have come out of Egypt. That's our believers. And it says, escape to the mountains, that you will not perish for the sins of Sodom and Gomorrah. And those of us who have come out of Sodom, out of Gomorrah, and they were looking to the mountaintop, were part of the bride of Christ. Yet we have answered the call and we're out. And then we now from polluted Babylon, perverted Babylon, and from the falling Babylon, we're out of the field of Babylon. And the call comes upon us. We must maintain that position. We must maintain that purity. We must maintain that separation from falling Babylon. And he calls us, the call to all believers. In 1 Peter chapter 1, reading from verse 15, but as he which has called you is holy, the one who called us is holy, the one who calls us is spotless, the one who calls us is blameless, and as he which has called you is holy, so be ye holy in all manner of conversation. Then he says in verse 16, because it is written, those who are going to heaven, they follow it is written. They don't follow opinions of men. They don't follow the practices of men. They don't follow the rites of religion. They don't follow denomination. They don't follow anything apart from it is written. A real child of God who has come out of Egypt, who has passed through the wilderness and is aiming at getting to Beulah land and getting to the land of glory. Anything that is not written in the word, anything that is not emphasized in the word, anything that is not plain in the word, he does not follow, but is setting his eyes on the writing, on the word of God, given by God. And if we're going to live with God, we must follow what is written. It says, because it is written, be ye holy, for I am holy. Holiness is possible for you, for me, for everyone, because the blood of the Lamb can make us holy. The word of the Lord can make us holy. The power of the Spirit can make us holy. The prayer of faith can make us holy. And as we come to God and we say, Lord, I want to be totally, completely, distinctly come out of falling Babylon, and I want to come out of the beastliness of this world, and I want to be in Beulah land in heaven on the final day, and I don't want any hurdle before me, any wall of demarcation before me, any wall of Jericho before me to keep me out. And you say, Lord, whatever it will take, a conversion, a consecration, a cleansing, a purging, a purifying, making holy, Lord, do it for me. He will do it for you. He'll get you ready for that land. Then you will say, I am holy, I am sanctified, not because of deeper life, I am holy, I'm righteous, not because of churchianity. I am holy, I am sanctified, not because I'm following after my parents, I'm following after somebody. I am holy because he that called me is holy, and I'm following what is written, because it is written, be holy, for I am holy. He will do it for you. He'll do it for me. He'll do it for everyone. And whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord, he calls you, and he calls you by name. And you call him, and you call him by name. And as both the divine and the human come together, he'll do in you what will qualify you for Beulah Land. Are you ready? Why don't you rise up and say, Lord, here am I want it done in my heart. It is written already, be ye holy, for I am holy. It will effect that in you. We call on Pastor Ogbodo, our state overseer, Anambra State, to come and lead us in prayer.
The Lord has spoken to us this morning, and we need to pray. Open your mouth and pray. All over us, all around us, we have Babylon with the filthiness, with the corruption, with the evil, and the Lord is saying, come out. And the call is urgent, very urgent. Because the Lord is coming soon. The coming of the Lord is very, very near. Come out of religion. Come into God's righteousness. The message is clear. If you linger in religion, you will be destroyed with the religious. If you linger in unrighteousness, it will be destroyed with the unrighteous. Look into your life. Are you clean? Are you free from sin? God calls you to come out. For your own good, God is calling you to come out. Enough of religion. It is a command. What God commands demands obedience. The soul that sinneth, it shall die. The soul in the world and the soul in the church, whoever sins, no matter when he or she is staying, no matter whether it's old or young, God calls all out of sin. And he's calling you. And you that are born again, you that say you belong to God, you are beloved of the Lord. You are the Israel of God. And God watches over you. God is jealous over you. And God is jealous over me. He wants me and he wants you to maintain righteousness. He wants you and he wants me to live in righteousness. And to be involved in calling those in sin to come out. It is our wisdom. It is my wisdom to hold on to his word, to obey his word. To reach out, to call on others to come out. Whatever it will cost, whatever the price is worth it. The price of speaking the truth. The price to stand on the truth. Rejection may come. Affliction may come. But the reward is there. Therefore, let's be in a number, calling all at this time out of Babylon, out of the world, out of religion, and the Lord will stand by us. And as the call came here this morning, you have no reason to remain in unrighteousness. You have no reason to remain in religion. Righteousness is available. Conversion is available. And the Lord is calling you this morning. Come out and come in. After conversion, God offers you a circumcision of your heart. God offers you a purifying of your heart. God wants all to be holy. God wants all to be holy. The filthiness of the world does not belong to the Christian. The filthiness of the world will disqualify a professing Christian for making it to heaven. Holiness is possible, and the Lord is calling all who profess to be with Him to live righteous and to live holy. Therefore, it is your wisdom to pray. Pray, and the Lord Himself will sanctify you wholly, will circumcise your heart, and will take away the root of sin and make you holy, just as He is holy. God's holiness, that is the standard. When God makes you holy, and when God makes one holy, He's holy in thoughts, is holy in decisions, is holy in actions. He's holy inwardly and outwardly. This nature of God is available unto all. And without holiness, no man, no woman, no one shall see the Lord. Without holiness, no entry into Beulah land. Without holiness, no place in heaven. And how can you be in a place like this? How can you be in such worship service and you are not able to find yourself in heaven at the end? God forbid. Therefore, pray. God is able and God is willing even now to make you holy, to make you fit for heaven. Many years in the faith, many years you have professed you are a Christian. But are you sure of a place in heaven? Are you sure you are part of those who will hear their names when the roll is being called? Lord, I want to be in the number. Lord, I want to be in number. If you pray, the Lord will answer your prayers. If you pray, the Lord will receive you unto himself. Ask God to help you. He has helped others. Whether you are old or you are young, there's room for you in God's kingdom. The qualification is come out, come in, and then you can come up. Out of Babylon, in to God's kingdom, and up into heaven. In Jesus' name we pray. Almighty God, we thank you for this glorious day. Thank you because you are merciful, you are loving, and you are receptive of all who are eager and who are willing to call upon your name, because they've seen their lives filthy, rotten, and they're unfit for heaven. Thank you because of your Son who died on the cross, who suffered to give salvation to all. Thank you because you know as many as are here this day who have seen themselves in religion and who are eager to come out of present-day Babylon. Lord, you know such ones one by one. And Lord, as I have called upon you with a desire to come out, Lord, I pray, according to your promise, receive all such ones unto yourself today in Jesus' name. And Lord, the grace to remain in the kingdom, the grace to press forward in the faith, the grace to receive all that accompanies salvation. Give unto all in Jesus' name. And Lord, even those who have prayed this morning for the second work of grace, to be sanctified and made holy, Lord, to be able to qualify to be in your kingdom at the end of life, Lord, I pray that this second work of grace will be their portions in Jesus' name. And Lord, I pray that all who are here this day will receive a touch from you. All who are born again, all who are qualified for the touch of holiness, for the touch of sanctification. Lord, I pray that all who have prayed unto you and have prayed in faith will receive such a touch this hour in Jesus' name. Lord, I pray that the assurance and the confidence of being in the number of people for whom Christ has gone to prepare a place, Lord, will steer all of us, all and sundry who are called by your name, to go about the business of the Lord, to go about in your service, and to lay all on the altar to serve you acceptably in Jesus' name. Whatever the afflictions, whatever the persecutions, whatever may try to hinder us, Lord, help us all to endure it all for the sake of the kingdom in Jesus' name. Lord, I pray that the grace to endure, the grace to persevere, the grace to continue, and continue faithful to the end, give unto all of us in Jesus' name. We're asking, Lord, that by your grace, we'll all be qualified. Qualified to be with you in the kingdom. Qualified to be with you at the end of our life. Qualified to receive a welcome from you at the end of our ministries in Jesus' name. We thank you, our Father, because we know you have answered us. Lord, we pray for our Father in the Lord, a living example of what we're talking about, a living example of conversion, a living example of consecration, a living example of commitment to the service of the Lord. Lord, we pray he will continue to bear him up. You continue to stand by him. You continue to strengthen him. You continue to keep him in good health while he serves you in Jesus' name. And Lord, as he labors to show us the way, as he labors to take us along, Lord, we pray we all will go with him into heaven at the end in Jesus' name. He will not miss his reward. He will not grow weary in well-doing. He will be strong to labor and labor and labor on the fullness of his years in Jesus' name. And Lord, his labors over us will not be in vain. We thank you because we know you have answered us. Help all of us, dear Lord, to make it together with him to heaven at the end of our lives in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord, for answering our prayers. In Jesus' name we pray.